So today I'm going to talk about how we prove equidistribution estimates for the primes. So to remind you where we're at, the main conjecture in this area is the Elliott-Halberstam conjecture. Which is the statement that for any theta up to one fixed, if you take the von Mangold function in arithmetic regressions, let's say between x and 2x, some large x, measures discrepancy, okay, you take the worst discrepancy in a given modulus, and then sum over all moduli up to this level, x to the theta, the conjecture is that you beat the trivial bound, which is x log x, by any power of log that you please. Okay? So this is the Elliott-Halberstam conjecture. If we had this conjecture, we could do quite a lot of things, especially if we had a certain technical generalization of it. Like you could prove prime caps of order 6, bounded by 6, for instance. Currently, we only have the Bombeau-Vinogradov theorem, which proves this statement up to 1/2. And we don't actually have any progress, even after the work of Zhang, on the Elliott-Halberstam conjecture for any theta bigger than 1/2. In fact, even equals 1/2, I think, is still open. What we do have is the following result of Zhang, that there exists some small parameters which he calls var p and delta. Actually, he just calls them var. In his paper, he takes, in fact, these parameters to be equal in less than about 1,000 or so. There exists some small constants, var p and delta, such that you have a weaker version of this. The soup is outside. And the q is can get a little bit above 1/2. A small amount of 1/2, we restrict it to be square free. And x to the delta smooth, or x to the delta friable, which means that the only primes that divide these q are less than x to the delta. So you only take smooth numbers, square free, you do the same thing. You measure the discrepancies in absolute value. Okay, you take the soup of all A that are co-prime to everything. These are co-prime to all primes less than x to the delta. So if you wish, you could take A in the profinite integers or something, but it doesn't really matter. You take this discrepancy, and this guy, you can get arbitrary log saving. Okay? This is what Zhang proved, and then later the polymath project improved, if I recall correctly, this threshold we could make about 10 times bigger.
And legally speaking, I think it's not exactly what he claimed.
Rules of all. So he didn't take the soup of all A. Yeah, his A was a specific A, but the proof goes through. Yeah, you have to. With a bit of tweaking. Okay, so Zhang plus epsilon. Okay. For the application to bounded gaps between primes, the specific A you need comes from a certain class of congruence classes that come from the Chinese remainder theorem. But you can abstract it. You can abstract away that hypothesis and state it like this, which I think is the cleaner way to state it actually. Because it's not clear you can actually use any special properties of A. You may as well just take to A arbitrary. A key point here is that A can be unbounded. For fixed A, there were previous results like this by Fouvry and Bombieri, Friedland, and Ivaniec. Not exactly like this. They didn't quite have this absolute value here, which is very useful for us. Instead, you take the sign sum weighted by some nice weight. But the absolute value is actually turns out not to. It just means you have to capture shorts a few more times than you would normally do. But the important thing is that this A can grow of X, can be very, so we don't assume A is bounded, and yet we have a bound which is uniform here. And that's sort of the novelty in one of the main novelties in Zhang's method. Yeah, so previous techniques which relied mostly on automorphic form methods, they needed a fixed or bounded. Okay, so that's the objective. All right, so the first step is what I said before, is that you first use the Heath-Brown identity. Okay, and what this does is that it splits the von Mangold function into a bunch of pieces, let's say polylog pieces. Okay, and each piece falls in one of three types, as it turns out, once you do the combinatorics. So there's type 0, there's what Zhang calls type 1 and type 2. There's a distinction which is not showing up yet, but in fact I won't even mention it. It's not so important, but okay. There are two types which are almost the same. And then there's a third type. Okay, so type 0 pieces of the von Mangold function look like convolutions of two weights, this guy supported on maybe say n2n, okay, m2n, this guy n2n. It's not so important, but in practice you don't actually make it n to 2n, you make it a little bit narrower than this, but not talk about that, it's not important. This is just some arbitrary rough weight. It has some bounds. Polylogarithmic in size, maybe up to some multiple of divisor function. Okay, so it's basically bounded up to polylog errors, but this guy is smooth. So this function should be coming from some smooth function supported on the unit interval, and so this is some smooth function with all derivatives bounded. Okay, so you take some smooth function from n to 2n, and you sample it at integers, and so you get a sort of discretized smooth function. So this is a nice smooth sequence, this is your friend. This guy is rough, it's got the same size, it's bounded, but it can oscillate in a way that is got all kinds of nasty arithmetic structure in it, and we don't try to exploit any structure inside this coefficient. Okay, so type 0 something looks like this, where mn is compo to x, and n is pretty big. Okay, the way you run the identity is bigger than 3/5, it turns out. Okay, type 1 and type 2 sums are similar. Now you're convolving two rough functions. So again, supported m to 2m, n to 2n. Let me just make sure my m's and n's are where I want them to be. Just so I don't confuse myself, although I'll probably confuse you. Now I want the alpha to be at scale n. And I was right the first time. What I want now, so these guys are now rough, they obey magnitude bounds, but no smoothness. Mn multiply to about x, and the way we're going to normalize it is that n is a small guy, m is the big guy, so this is small and this is wide, and they're between x to the 3/5, x to the 2/5. Okay, so you have two rough functions at scales close to x to the 1/2, within about x to the 1/10 of x to the 1/2. You're combining two rough guys together, so you get sort of these bilinear rough sums. The distinction between type 1 and type 2 is that it turns out for technical reasons that when n and m are both very close to root x, the argument for type 1 doesn't quite work and you have to use a slightly different argument, but that's a relatively minor point. And then finally, the type 3 sums look like a quadruple convolution. So this guy's rough and supported at some scale, m2m. These guys are smooth and supported at scales n1, n2, and n3. And again, they have to multiply up to x, otherwise they won't contribute to your sum. And these guys are fairly big. Yes? Oh, okay. Okay. All right, so these are medium size actually. N1 is between N2 and N3, are between x to the 2/5 and x to the 1/5. But their products are big, so like N1 and N2, for example, is at least N to the 3/5. Okay, so the precise numbers are not so important, but okay, this is sort of medium size. A good example to keep in mind here is if you just drop this, you should think of just a triple convolution where all these guys are supported at scale x 1/3. That's a good model case. This is also a component of either the second or third divisor function. I don't know the conventional notation. Is it tau 2 or tau 3? Tau 3, okay. Yeah, if you convolve one over itself three times, yeah, okay, that makes sense. Okay, we call it tau 3. Then you get pieces that look like this. So the type 3 sums are very similar to the third divisor function, which has been studied quite intensively. So in fact, before Zhang's work, there were existing results on the distribution of tau 3, I think first by Friedlander and Ivanyec, and then Heath Brown, and then Fouvry, Karvatsky, and Michel. Zhang had a different, slightly different way of dealing with that sum, but actually it turns out that the recent work of Fouvry, Karvatsky, and Michel gives quite good results for this type 3 sum. To the extent, in fact, that we understand this sum quite well, this is no longer the worst sum. There's the type 1 and type 2 sums that actually we understand the least. Okay, so this is what the Heath-Brown decomposition gives you. I should remark that if you enlarge the range of the type 1 and type 2 sum, so instead of being between 2/5 and 3/5, if you enlarge this class to lie between 1/3 and 2/3, so distance 1/6 from 1/2 rather than 1/10, then you don't need the type 3 terms anymore. Okay, and in fact, you can just use Vaughan's identity to get the decomposition you need. You don't need this more difficult, not that much more difficult, Heath-Brown identity. Okay, so there is some games you can play. You know, if you don't like one of these, you wanted a shorter proof of these equidistribution estimates with maybe a worse value of these VARP and delta parameters, you could just prove type 1 and type 2 estimates and not deal with type 3 estimates.
This just instead
of 3. Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. These are the numbers. We've re-optimized them over Zhang. Yeah, Zhang has slightly different numbers here. Yeah, there was a 3/8, as I remember. It evolved over time because as our technology improved, we improved the bounds for either this on type 1 or type 2 or type 3 estimates, and every time we did that, we had to remove the optimal thresholds between the two and so forth. Okay, but this is where they ended up. So nowadays, the type 3 estimates are proven. Ultimately, the main tool that comes in here is Deligne's work on the Riemann hypothesis. On varieties of finite fields, which allows you to control higher dimensional exponential sums. And currently, we don't know of any way I don't think we have any way to do the type 3 sums without using the input of Deligne right now. The type 1 and type 2 sums, you can use Deligne if you want to get the best bounds, but actually it turns out that you don't have to. You can bound the type 1 and type 2 sums using the more elementary, well, the easier Riemann hypothesis on curves due to André Weil, which gives you control of one-dimensional sums, which turns out to be enough for the type 1 and type 2 sums, although you can stick in the more advanced Deligne estimates to move the exponents up a little bit more if you want. Which means that if you only use, if you mess around with the thresholds and eliminate the type 3 estimates using Vaughan's identity, you can, if you want, prove some equidistribution estimates without ever having to use Deligne's work. But the exponents you get are worse. Okay, the best results, you need both. Okay, so all right. So how do you prove? So now what you have to do is that you need to prove equidistribution estimates for each of these three sort of pieces. Okay, so the type 0 estimates are very easy. if you have a type zero sum, the thing is that this coefficient is so smooth and so wide, it's wider than x to the 3/5, which is wider than this q. So q remember is going to be it's basically x to the 1/2 plus a little bit. It's basically x to the 1/2. You don't need to do any number theory to count this. You just go ahead, you just split it up. Okay, you just split up the sum into a double sum, and basically psi is supported it's smooth at some scale of size 3/5, and q is less than x to the 1/2 plus a little bit. So n is being restricted to some arithmetic progression, mod q, which is much smaller in scale than the scale for which the smooth function is living over, and so just almost any technique will work here to estimate the sum. You can either use Poisson summation or quadrature or whatever, or the Maclaurin or something. Again, lots of things will work, and you get great bounds here. So you can this is easy to estimate. Okay, so the type zero sums are not the difficult ones. So let's talk about the type one sums, and I think I need a full board, so I think I'll start over. Now, the actual details in bookkeeping are really messy, and so I'm not going to actually show you actual computations with any precision. I just want to give you sort of the flavor of the type of things you do. In particular, why is it important? I just erased it. But why is it important that you have square free and smooth and so forth? This will show up very shortly. Okay. So to estimate the type one sums, the type of thing that you, the type of sum that you care about, yeah, you're summing over all q, which are just a little bit bigger than 1/2. I'll just call it x to the 1/2 plus square free. I'll just call it smooth and not worry about exactly how smooth. And then you've got an absolute value, and then you've got a sum n equals a mod q of a convolution of two rough pieces, and let's say for the sake of concreteness that this guy is rough at the scale x to the 3/5, and this one at scale x to 2/5. So this is sort of the extreme case of the type one sums, minus the mean, which I'll not write on explicitly, and you want to control this sort of sum. All right. So how do you do this? So the first thing is that we want to get these absolute values are annoying. So I will delete them, but to delete them, you have to pay a price, which is an arbitrary coefficient. This is just some sign, plus or minus one, depending on the sign. Okay, and we don't control much about the sign. It's either plus or minus one. So eventually, the only thing we can do with it at some point is either kill it by the triangle inequality or by Cauchy-Schwarz. But we don't do that just yet because we need to do some other maneuvers first. Okay, so we unpack that. Then this, of course, you can split into a double sum. Okay, and then of course there's another term which I'm not going to write down. And then there's this. Now this q. Okay, so here's where we start using the fact that you're smooth. Okay, so smooth is sort of the opposite of prime. It means that you're the product of many, many small factors, and so. Here's the numbers from 1 to q. Okay, if q is prime, then there's no factors between 1 and q. But if q is smooth, then you have lots and lots of factors between 1 and q. So if for example, your x to the delta is smooth, so that no prime factor is bigger than x to the delta, then it's easy to see just from the greedy algorithm that if you take any intermediate number, say r, and r times x to the delta, there are so many factors of q that there must be at least one factor of q between the interval r and r to the x to the delta for any r in between. Because you just keep multiplying the factors of q one at a time, the primes of q one at a time, and because they have always small jumps, at some point you must fall into this, it's just the basically intermediate value theorem. Okay, discrete version. Okay, so basically, if forgetting this x to the delta, basically you can factorize q wherever you want. The q is well factorable in some sense. Okay, so you can basically you can split Q into two factors, which being square free leaves with co-prime, and you can basically place them wherever you want, and it. Okay, we're a bit of prescience. I'll tell you where you want to factor them. So it turns out that if x is of size about 1/2 plus a little bit, you're factoring into two pieces r, and r is going to be about x to the 2/5 minus a little bit, so s is going to be x to the 1/10 plus two little bits to cancel that. Okay, so you can factor any q into these two pieces, r and s. Actually, okay, just because my notation, oh, that was, okay, this was, I'll call this q prime, I'm sorry. This is bad of me, but okay. Although I'll confuse myself if I don't follow my own notation. Okay, so you can split your original modulus into a modulus of size about x to the 1/10 and a modulus of size x to the 2/5 minus a little bit. And the point of this minus is that it's just a little bit. So basically, the scale of r is going to be just a tiny bit lower than the scale of n. And this turns out to be the important thing. OK, so you can split cube. You can factorize this. OK, and so if you do that, you should do that before you take the absolute values, turn them into signs. So actually, keep the absolute values here, split up the sum, and then introduce the sign. So if you do all that, you start staring at a sum that looks something like this. So n is of size x. So it looks kind of scary because there's so many summations over there. But actually, having lots of summations is your friend because you have many opportunities to cancel and do Cauchy-Schwarz and so forth. So actually, okay, and then there's some other term which I'm not going to write down. Okay, so we now have two moduli. And we have two parameters here, okay, and there's this constraint which is now QR, okay, and so you have this sum here, so okay, so the whole game is to rearrange, and in such a way that you can actually do something useful like a Cauchy-Schwarz or something. So. At this point, we were following what Zhang did. I imagine he must have proceeded by trial and error for many years, actually. It's not obvious always how to actually arrange these things in such a way that you would actually get somewhere. There were previous works of Bombier Friedlander Advantage that did similar things. Okay, so the way we're going to control this is, first of all, the R sum, you can exploit averaging in R, but actually you can even get type 1 estimates without averaging in R. So I'm just going to forget the R sum. So let's just kill the R summation. And then I want to rearrange put the M out in the front. Okay. There is a Q. And there's a constraint. So think of R is now just fixed. Okay, and then we have what's left. There's a beta of n somewhere, and there's some coefficients. Okay, and then there's another term. Okay, so you rearrange the sum a little bit. Now, why is this the right way to rearrange things? Okay, so R, remember, is of size x to the 2/5 minus a little bit. Okay, we can count how many terms are in this sum. Okay, so this sum, the number of n's and q's here is about x to the 2/5 times x to the 1/10 plus a little bit. Okay, but we're not summing over all of them. We have to quotient because we have this congruence condition. Okay, we're only summing over all those n and q for which m and n is equal to a mod qr. And if you pick n and q at random, the chance that this congruence condition satisfies is like 1 over qr. All right, so really, the number of terms here should be this times this divided by qr, which is q is about this size, and R is about this size. Okay, and so because we've chosen R to be just a little bit shy of this n, you have a non-trivial sum here. Okay, so there's just a tiny bit of gain. Okay? There's a tiny bit of summation going on here. This is a slightly non-trivial sum. But even if you have just a tiny bit of summation, then you can set up what is called the Linux dispersion method, which is basically a particular way to apply Cauchy-Schwarz. Okay, because now that you have a non-trivial sum here, you can apply Cauchy-Schwarz. Well, I mean, you can apply Cauchy-Schwarz, you know, even with a trivial sum, but you're not going to get anything interesting. Okay, let me just say this whole thing in squared. You can apply Cauchy-Schwarz here, okay, and this is something that you understand. And so the whole point is that you get rid of at least one rough guy. So alpha was one of these rough things we didn't understand. You can eliminate it. Actually, strictly speaking, you don't completely eliminate it. You replace it by a smooth cutoff. But maybe I'll just hide that. Okay, this sum should be thought of as sort of a smooth sum. Okay, so you would get this thing you understand, and you just need to understand this sort of sum. So you can expand this out as a double sum. N comma q, and then maybe an n prime comma q. So you can take q1 and q2, obeying various conditions. Okay, and you have some big thing in the middle here. And as I said last time, when you have that square, there are two terms. There's a diagonal term when these guys are the same, and an off-diagonal term when they're not the same. And the whole point of having a slightly non-trivial sum here is that the diagonal term is a little bit smaller than the trivial bound. Okay, and we only need to gain just a few logs from the trivial bound. So the diagonal term is negligible because we have a non-trivial sum here. Okay, and so therefore we can disperse the sums, and we can deal with two n's. We can deal with the case when these guys are not the same. Okay, so if you do that, what do you end up looking at? Okay, modulo terms that you understand pretty well. Okay, so. What we should get, so we have an M, which is of a certain size, and an N prime of a certain size, Q1 and Q2 of a certain size, and N, let's say NM is equal to A mod Q1 R, and N prime M is equal to A mod Q2 R. Okay, and then you got some coefficients. Okay, so there's like a beta of N, a beta of N prime, CQ1R, C, okay. It looks kind of bad here because like we don't control anything about these coefficients, but it's remarkable that there's still cancellation in this sum. I mean, there's also minus here, okay. There's still actually a lot of cancellation here. It's not so apparent yet, but so this looks kind of messy, but now we're starting with five terms, but we can cut things down a little bit. Right now, nm and n prime m are the same mod r, which means that n and n prime are the same mod r. You can ensure that various things are coprime, or a is coprime to everything. So you can invert. So n and n prime actually have to differ by multiple of r, but n and n prime are already of size x to the 2/5, and r is of size x to the 2/5 minus. So there's basically n determines n prime up to a very small error. So n prime you can think of as just n plus a small shift. Times R and L is small. Okay, so just for simplicity, I'm just going to ignore the shift. Okay, and I'll just look at the diagonal term, n prime equals n. It's already kind of typical. Just for simplicity, I will just look at the diagonal term. That's already a pretty typical term. So that simplifies things a little bit. Okay, so we'll just take a diagonal term, and these guys are different because we assume that the pair n q1 and n prime q2 are different. So q1 and q2 are different. Actually, with a bit of work, you can ensure that not only are the q1 and q2 different, they're actually coprime. Let me just ignore that. That's a sort of technical step. These are actually coprime. you have to go to do that. You have to go back to an earlier factorization, make sure that Q has no small prime factors, put all the small prime factors into R. But anyway, you have an expression like this. All right, so we rearrange again. So you know this expression is kind of messy, but the there's one variable in which things are really good, which is M, because nothing depends on M. Okay, so. All right, so we can just rearrange this sum. Okay. Okay, so there's some smooth sum here. That's like 3/5, and there's a constraint. M has to be of the order of A over N mod Q. There were two constraints here, I'm sorry. I should not have erased this one. You have to combine them by the Chinese remainder theorem. Okay, I guess something like that. If you had the L, it would be a bit more complicated, but let's just do it like this. And then one. Okay. Now, how big is this modulus here? So R is of size x to the 2/5 minus. And these guys are of size x to the 1/10 plus a little bit. So if you put it all together, this modulus is x to the 3/5 plus a little bit, if you work it out. Okay. And so this is pretty good. Okay, the spacing here is only just a little bit wider than the width of this sum. Okay, so this is almost something that is easy to compute. If this was just a little bit smaller, then Poisson summation or whatever would work really well, and you would get a very good bound on this sum. But it's just a little bit bigger, you know. Which means you actually have to care a little bit about what this residue class is. Sometimes you don't actually hit this interval or not, but you don't have to care too much. In this cyclic group, you know, you're summing a really big range, is almost the full size. And it's so dense that Fourier analytic methods begin to become effective. So what you should do here, actually, is that you should take this cutoff function, like the cutoff to this scale, and break it up into Fourier modes. And then estimate each Fourier mode separately, take absolute values. You will lose a factor based on the ratio of this and this, but that's something that is a tolerable loss. So what you should do is that you should do Fourier expansion or Poisson summation, or same thing, really. So if you break this up into Fourier modes, what ends up happening is that you start staring at sums that look like this. Okay. Okay, so if you Fourier expand this thing, then you eventually end up looking at a sum. So these guys haven't changed. So still a bunch of scary coefficients here. Okay, but what this is, it becomes basically an exponential phase, something like this. H-O-N. Okay, so here we're working in a cyclic group, Q1, Q2, R and EQ on Q2 R of anything, just e to the 2 pi I, is the fundamental character of this. Okay, and H is some Fourier mode. It isn't, well, yeah, H is something of size about the ratio of this thing. So H is pretty small. And actually, you sum over H. And if you want to be really efficient, you actually want to exploit averaging of H. But let's not talk about H. So there's some H, and you can assume H is non-zero. Because there was this main term that we kept hiding from you, and actually at this point the main term happens to exactly equal the zero mode, and you can cancel it off here. So there's some non-zero H here, and so now you have an expression that begins to look more like an exponential sum. Okay, we've got an exponential sum, but you also have.
You divide by H.
You divide by N. Yeah, so M is constrained to equal this congruence class. So if you expand that out by a Fourier expansion, you'll get something like this. Then you can multiply by the Fourier coefficient of this cutoff function at H and sum over H. But okay, but
the inverse
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is this. Yeah, this is division in this ring. This is not. Okay. I mean, yeah, I guess people also use. You could use this notation if you like instead. All right. Okay. So you have this sum. So you have these rough coefficients. Okay. So you. You have to deal with them. Right. So you have to cauchy Schwarz a few times to get rid of the last few things you don't understand. So what you do first is that you pull out the n sum. So there's a certain phase here. Okay, so you pull this out and you cauchy Schwarz to get rid of this beta, and if you do that, you start staring at what is looking to be quite complicated, you have to have a certain amount of faith that things are getting better. I mean, you have to be sort of an optimist to do this sort of business. Okay. Okay, so if you split things up, you know, it temporarily looks bad because you're getting more and more unknown coefficients, not less, when you're doing this. But okay, so you do a cauchy Schwarz. And you get an expression that looks like this. Okay, so it looks like there's more terms. But finally, there is one variable for which is not hitting any of the coefficients you don't understand, okay, which is n. Okay, so if you rearrange that, finally. As long as you get enough summations floating around, then cauchy Schwarz eventually wins for you. That will give you some cancellation. Unless things are really degenerate. Because you're losing things elsewhere, you know, we lost a little bit from Fourier's expansion and so forth, it's not always clear that the gains outweigh the losses. And so there's a delicate game to play still. But at least when var p is and delta very small, this will win. Okay, so when you rearrange, it all comes down to understanding some expression like this. Okay, so if you can understand the absolute value of these guys and get a good bound, if you can beat the trivial bound by a lot, then you're in good shape. Now this you can combine by some.
I think any scale of size x to the 2/5, no?
X to the. I'm sorry, 2/5. Right. Okay. Yeah. So. All right. So this you can by some Chinese remainder theorem. And the worst case is when these are all coprime. Okay. Turns out that you can combine all these terms into a single expression like this. So this becomes an incomplete sort of Sally sum, or whatever. Klusterman sum. In general, it's not quite this simple. There was this L that was zero earlier, and actually, it's in actually there's a. In general, you have to do a slightly more complicated sum, but. All right, so it's. So the kind of thing you're staring at is a sum like this. And the size of this modulus, okay, so we do the math again. Okay, so R is x to the 2/5 minus a little bit. These guys are all x to the 1/10 plus a little bit. This adds up to about 4/5 plus a little bit. Whatever, okay. All right. you can sort of see why we only can only get like 1 of 100 and so forth for our deltas and so forth. Okay, so here it's a relatively short sum. The length of the sum is about the square root of the length of the full sum. Now we were inefficient. There are actually slightly smarter ways to Cauchy Schwarz in such a way that when you do all this, you actually have a sum which is a little bit bigger than the square root. Here, the way I did it was a little bit less than the square root. But if you're smarter, you can make it a little bit less than bigger than the square root, which is then good because So the type of problem you're faced with is just a special case of a more general question of can you control incomplete exponential sums of some rational function here over some modulus, which is some nice big smooth modulus, over some range here, and n you should think of as being a lot less than q. So it's a very incomplete sum. Okay, so the Riemann hypothesis is your friend. If you have a complete sum, then as long as f is not completely trivial, the Riemann hypothesis gives you bounds of the order of square root of q. And actually, because q is not very prime, it's actually plus 1 plus epsilon, but okay. But essentially, you get a square root cancellation for the complete sum. Now, if you have an incomplete sum, then one of the standard ways to convert an incomplete sum to complete sum is the Polyvinogradov method, which is basically just to take this cutoff and Fourier expand it. And so you can Fourier expand this guy into combinations of complete sums, and there'll be a bunch of these guys, but completion is a little bit inefficient. There's an inefficiency which is based on the ratio between this scale and this scale, and so if you do completion and then you apply this bound, what you get is that you get something like n of q over n times root q to the 1 plus epsilon. Which unfortunately, this type of Polyvinogradov type bound, this would be non-trivial only for q bigger than only for n a lot bigger than root q. That's the standard square root limit to Polyvinogradov. Okay, so you want to control shorter sums. So in general, this gets hard. So even for the simplest situation, character sums. If you wanted to shrink below root q, you can do it, but you have to use this method of Burgess, which is not particularly well. I mean, it's really a little bit tricky for characters, and you want to apply it for Clustermann sums and so forth. Again, you can in principle do it, but it is quite tricky. But strangely enough, the conventional wisdom is that prime sums are simpler than composite sums because we have the Riemann hypothesis of prime sums and we always try to do prime sums first. But actually, there are some cases in which having a very composite or smooth modulus is very helpful. So rather than use the Burgess type methods, it turns out to be more efficient to use a different method. Due to Graham and Ringrose, and also Heath Brown, although I'm not sure exactly how the relationship is between, but okay, so someone called the Q van der Kolbert method. So this turns out to be a very good way to control these medium length exponential sums. Yeah, so if you have a short exponential sum, like this, then you can introduce some intermediate averaging. So we have this van der Kolbert averaging method, which is that you can introduce some additional averaging parameters, where these are much smaller than size n. Take this sum and shift it around by some h in some parameter set, and you've got to average it. And then you can interchange, well, this is basically the same. You can interchange the sums in Cauchy Schwarz, and at the end of the day, what you end up with, and then there's some more averaging going on here. Okay. So you can cache Schwartz one of these sums into a sum that looks something like this. Okay, times another cache Schwartz term that you understand very well. Okay, now if f was a polynomial, then this is the Vowel differencing trick, and this works very well because if f is a polynomial of some degree, the differences have a lower degree, and so this gives you good estimates. In our case, f is a rational function, and if you differentiate a rational function, actually things get worse. The degree gets bigger rather than smaller. So ordinarily, this isn't a win. Except that you get to pick where you shift. And so the idea of the Q van der Kolpert method is that if Q is very smooth, it can be factored into pieces. And as I said before, you can pick where the factors are. And you can choose your shifts to be multiples of one of these two terms. Let's say that these H's are multiples of R. Okay? So you only shift by multiples of R. And the reason you do that is then this difference becomes divisible by R. And so rather than being over this big modulus, this reduces to E of a smaller modulus of some other polynomial, which depends on various parameters. But you can replace one exponential sum by another exponential sum over a smaller modulus. But whereas the length gets of the sum is still unchanged. And so if you had a short sum, you can turn a short sum into a relatively larger sum relative to the modulus than what you started with before. And in particular, you can get past this root Q threshold for Polyakov and Nagradov. So if you apply this method, it turns out, so the Polyakov and Nagradov method gives you non-trivial results for when your length is at bigger than root Q. If you apply this van der Kolpert method once, you can enlarge the range for which you have a non-trivial bound. And you can get a non-trivial on all for sums as short as Q 1/3. If you apply it again, so you can iterate this, and you can get up to Q 1/4, Q 1/5, and so forth. Although in practice, because of the Cauchy-Schwarz, every time you apply this method, the gain you get halves. And actually, it turns out that there is not a win. Actually, we only van der Kolpert once, because actually we experimented with multiple van der Kolperts. We actually ended up with worse exponents than when you started with. But you can actually improve. You can improve the range for which you can get exponents. In fact, there's also this is actually called the Q van der Kolpert A process. There's something called the Q van der Kolpert B process, which is Plancherel. And if you apply them both, then you can actually get all exponent pairs if you know what that is. Okay, but for this sort of application, you just need to get a little bit below square root of Q, and so this would be enough. At least if your original alpha and beta are pretty close to square root of x. If you want to get this larger range of type 1 sums between x 1/3 and x 2/3, then you have to think if you use this twice or maybe three times. But basically, using this method, you can get non-trivial bounds for this sum, which will eventually feed back to give you enough cancellation to get a non-trivial type 1 estimate for these type 1 and type 2 sums. Okay, so in the last few minutes, I'll talk about the type 3 sums. Which actually nowadays are actually not. If you are willing to take the Lean's results as a black box, they're actually simpler than this. I mean, there's a lot less of this Cauchy-Schwarz. I mean, there's still lots of Cauchy-Schwarz and Fourier extension, but it's not quite as intricate. Okay, so let me just look at a model case. We're just going to take a triple convolution, where these guys are of size about x 1/3. Okay, and yes, this minus something, and then absolute value. Okay, which is the same as sticking in some coefficient here. Okay, so we wish to understand an expression, a discrepancy like this for the type 3 sums. Okay, so you expand this out, and Q is of size of x 1/2 plus a little bit. Okay. So if you expand this out, then what you get is you get sum of n1, n2, n3, all of size about x 1/3, q, which is bigger, x 1/2, and then you're summing basically cutoffs. Okay. Okay. And there's a congruence classical condition. N1, N2, N3. Okay, so the modulus is much bigger than each one of these ranges. So these ranges are living in some sort of reasonably small subinterval of Z mod QZ, if you like. But what you can do, and this is expensive, is that you can try to expand these guys into, you do a Fourier expansion. Z mod QZ. Now, this is not particularly efficient because the width of these intervals, x to 1/3, is a lot narrower than the total modulus here. So you're going to lose something here. And so you need to pay it back with quite a bit later on. And this is where you need Deligne, because Deligne is the only guy who can give you lots and lots of cancellation. but if you expand this out into a Fourier series, you start looking at expressions that look something like this. So there'll be a sum over H1, H2, H3, which are size about the ratio of these guys, about H to 1/6. Then you have something for N1, N2, N3 in a cyclic group, obeying this congruence condition. And you have some nice exponential sum in the middle here. And there's still a coefficient here. This is what you get after Fourier expansion. Now, it's inefficient. If you bound this trivially, you will not recover the trivial bound here. There's the price you have, the inefficiency here is the ratio between the width of this interval and the modulus here 3 times. So there's like 1/6 3 times. So you lose about x 1/2 plus a little bit. Because of Fourier expansion. So you've lost the whole square root, and plus a little bit more, which is a bit bad. But we keep going. Now we have this expression. These H's, you can change variables. Now that you're in this ring, you just dilate the N's by the H's. You have to cut out the case when the H has a common factor of Q. That's technical, actually really annoying, to be honest. But let's just ignore that. But if H is co-prime to Q, you can scale those out, and they just come in here. And this has a nice feature. I think this was first exploited by Heath Brown. Is that
Marcelli from Hauptin short intervals in grad of chain, then in other type, this gluing of these frequencies is a technique daily bad. Sorry, but the guy does not understand, but does not emphasize that.
I did not realize. So the next trick is apparently quite an old trick, which is that this whole sum depends on H1, H2, H3 only through the product. So you can just make a change of variables. And so you can concatenate 3 small sums into 1 big sum. You pay a small price. You pay basically essentially a divisor function, a truncated divisor function, but because of some multiplicity here. But it's still a win. So you end up with an expression like this. Now, this is just a pure exponential sum over a finite field. It has a name. This is called the Hyper-Clusterman sum. In fact, the third Hyper-Clusterman sum of AH at Q. And the way it's usually normalized is it's actually Q times this. So the Hyper-Clusterman sum. One over Q times the sum of N1, N2, N3 equals AQ. Of this expression here. So it's an exponential sum over about Q squared terms. Yeah, because of this Q cubed terms here with one congruence relation. So it's Q squared terms, but so if you expect square root cancellation, then this should be of size, this should be of bounded size. So this is the type of expression that you have. And so this is one of the things that Deligne can certainly deal with. If you use the Riemann hypothesis for this hypersurface here, what you find is that the Secchi bounded, well, up to negligible errors because of all the prime factors of Q. But this is essentially bounded. Okay, so that you get a square root cancellation. You get a square root cancellation of Q, which, if I did things correctly, should exactly balance.
The first loss.
Right. I'm just a little bit perturbed because one is a Q. I lost the x to the 1 half and again a Q to the 1 half. I gained a Q? Yes, okay, all right. I gained a Q, which is about x to the 1 half, yeah. Okay, so, yeah, so there's so much cancellation in this estimate. So this beats the trivial bound by basically Q. Okay, and Q is about the same size as x to the 1 half. So you've almost recovered all the loss that you had before. Now, this doesn't end the story because it's just a little bit short. Okay, so we're almost back to where we started, but you just need just a little bit more cancellation than what we have here. And anything you do will give you something non-trivial. Okay. So basically, what that tells you is that you just have to start Cauchy-Schwarzing again. So by the way, if you try the same thing for tau 4, it doesn't work because the lean doesn't save you enough to counter the loss. And we just don't know how to do it tau 4. But tau 3 is just within the reach of these methods. Okay, so last thing then. All right, so you deal with this. Okay, so again, you exploit the smoothness of Q. You split Q into two pieces, both the size by x to the 1 quarter. One of the sums I'll just throw away. You can exploit it if you want, but I'll just throw away, say, the S sum. And so if you do this, you end up with some expression which looks something like this. Okay, this is the type of thing you're looking at. And then you Cauchy-Schwarz to get rid of this annoying thing. So if you do a Cauchy-Schwarz, okay, so then you get a bunch of coefficients which look a little scary, but then you have this, well, actually this is kind of scary too, but okay, you get the product of these two Clouston weights, these guys don't turn on H. So what you should do is that you should put this guy in here, move this sum in here, and you Cauchy-Schwarz one more time, or not. Actually, no, you don't need to do that. Okay. Yeah, it's already complete in H. Yeah. So okay. So what you have here, this is like an incomplete exponential sum, but rather than having exponential sums, it's an incomplete sort of Clouston. The exponential functions are replaced by these more complicated expressions, which are still bounded, but they're sort of generalized exponential phases. They're what's called trace weights. And it turns out that if you understand Dalin's theory well enough, you can get cancellation for these sort of correlations as well. I guess maybe Emmanuel will talk about this in a week or two. So it turns out that you can use Dalin one more time and get some non-trivial cancellation, quite a good actually non-trivial cancellation in here. And if you pass that through, you will get actually quite a good type 3 estimate. It's so strong, in fact, that it's no longer the dominant barrier to improving further improvements to these estimates. Because we weren't Cauchy-Schwarzing nearly as much somehow as with the other. And also we're exploiting really strong cancellation, square root cancellation, rather than sort of like the van der Kolbe methods only give you like 1/6 gain and so forth. It's not so strong. But this part we actually understand quite well. Of course, modulo having to use Dalin's theory. But yeah, you put that all together and you actually get non-trivial estimates on equity estimates on the primes. Okay, that's a good place to stop. Thank you.
Have we had questions?
Or maybe I should have, because you didn't mention strongly enough this new version of Van der Kolk, which is not used, was not used by Jean, but that was your contribution.
So Zhang instead did some more efficient Cauchy-Schwarz so that he could just use Polyvinogradov. Yeah, so in Polymath, we did his efficient Cauchy-Schwarz and Van der Kolk. We used everything to get the best possible bound. Yeah.
Without this Van der Kolk, the type 3 is combined with type 2. The point when the matching is
right,
for the best result, but in your approach now, as you said at the last moment, tells you more and more contribute to the optimization. Because of Van der Kolk, which you matter?
That's one of the biggest gains. Yeah, we also exploit a lot more averaging than Zhang did. There's a lot of parameters averaging that we just threw away. Which I also threw away here for simplicity, but if you save a lot of the averages, basically any average that doesn't affect the modulus, but it just affects whatever's inside the parentheses, is something that you can exploit by these sort of exponential sum methods. What is difficult is trying to exploit cancellation when you vary the modulus, and we can't use automorphic methods for a variety of reasons. That's the only thing I know that would do that. I mean, we don't do that.
Other thing, there's an opportunity to mention, is when you use automorphic stuff, A must be fixed, but it doesn't necessarily be small, it's just the point is that it's fixed, you know. It could be very large if it's a Ramanujan conjecture. It's really the fact that A is moving to the modulus, which led itself to Zhang. And it's not the weakness of modular forms as spectral theory, it is just the fact that averaging over Q cannot be taken advantage of because it moves with A. That's the reason. And so when you said here that N1 is compared to N2 modulo Q, and Q is tiny smaller than N, in another to get good result, we just switched the modulus, and 1 minus N2 over Q is another modulus, and this switching requires A not depending on Q. It's not really the spectral theory of automorphic forms which prohibits A to be large or small. It's just the A moving with Q. If you switch the modulus Q into the complementary modulus, how do you control what is A in terms of the new modulus? That's the point. And so Zhang succeeded not to use that switch. Mm-hmm. And that's the innovation you need. Okay, that's my viewpoint.
Another question or comment?
So maybe just one comment. So I will talk about these things indeed next week, and I'm planning to try and finish the whole course with the estimate, explaining how one can nowadays, knowing a little bit of Deligne's work as a black box, prove for oneself such estimates quite easy.
Good. Yeah, stick around.
Okay, so no more questions. We can make a big thank to